We're here.
Welcome to Egypt.
مرحبا جلا بيت بيجيب.
نورت مصر.
خطوة عزيزة.
أهلا بيكم في مصر.
أهلا وسهلا.
نورتونا.
Welcome. Welcome to Egypt.
يا مرحب يا مرحب.
شرفتونا.
أهلا.
Welcome to Egypt.
Welcome to Sharm
el-Sheikh.
Welcome to Egypt.
Welcome to
COP27. Welcome to Sharm
el-Sheikh. Welcome to COP27.
Welcome to Egypt.
أهلا بكم في مصر. Welcome to Egypt. Our distinguished guests from Egypt, the cradle of civilization, from Sinai, the blessed land, welcome to COP27. من مصر مهدي الحضارة من أرض سيناء المباركة نرحب بكم في قمة المناخ 27 المنعقدة في أول مدينة مصرية.
We welcome you to COP27, meeting for the first time in Sharm el-Sheikh, the first green city. Ladies and gentlemen, your meeting today, participating in this summit, is testimony to your desire to put an end to climate change, which is affecting life on our planet. We will be pooling our efforts today together for implementation. That's the slogan of this conference. COP27. Let's not forget that we are in many ways the cradle of civilization, Egypt, but also I think we have a brilliant future ahead of us. I'd like to welcome His Excellency Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, President of Egypt.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أصحاب الجلالة والفخر.
In the name of Allah, the Merciful, Your Majesties, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I would like to warmly welcome you, every one of you, to Egypt. This country, which I hope you will consider as a second homeland, because we are happy to welcome you on this Egyptian land. We have every intention to work hand in hand with you in all areas together. Today, we have come together to work on one of the most urgent issues faced by the planet, the issue of climate change. During this conference of parties, the United Nations from a convention on climate change coming together during this COP27 held here in Sharm el-Sheikh, a city of peace. In fact, the first city in Egypt that has gone through the beginnings of a green transformation. And across the planet, all eyes are on us today as we initiate this most important conference. There are great expectations for high results as millions of people across the world are looking to us. They are hoping for a healthier environment, a cleaner environment, an environment healthier for development, for life, for work, and more respectful of the diminishing resources of this planet, which must become more sustainable. Millions of people across the planet have their gazes turned towards us, as was the case last year. We're talking about women, children, young people, workers, all human beings across this planet. they all share one future, and they all share one goal and one hope, that same hope that we cherish also here. And through the media, people in all countries are watching us. They have thorny, difficult questions and challenges, and we must pose these questions. Are we today closer to the achievement of our goals compared to previous years? Have we faced our responsibilities as leaders of our government, heads of state? Have we faced the challenges of climate change to protect the most vulnerable? These are key thorny questions, fundamental questions. For example, do we cherish true ambitions to achieve these goals? Can we achieve our goals? Can they be achieved with the goodwill and intentions that we have to achieve those goals that we face due to climate change by pooling our resources? Can we all work together? Do we have any other choice but to bring concrete action together? And so we must respond to the expectations of people across the world, people who are suffering more than ever the consequences of natural catastrophes. The intensity and frequency have never been so severe. And this is true in all four corners of the world. We have seen one catastrophe after another. As soon as we tackle one catastrophe, another arises. Wave after wave of suffering and losses, suffering by billions of people. The planet has become a world of suffering today. Therefore, we must step back and reiterate the question, is it not high time today to put an end to all this suffering? Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, what does the world need today to overcome today's climate change crisis and to implement the content of our agreements and the Paris Agreement? It's something that goes beyond mere words. The people of the world are looking to us today, and they want a rapid, concrete implementation of genuine, physical, practical, concrete actions to reduce emissions, to reinforce the ability to adapt, to guarantee the funding necessary for developing countries who today are suffering more than others the consequences of these crises. It is thus that we compiled the catchphrase of this conference, Together for Implementation, the Climate Implementation Summit, because despite all the challenges that we have faced in past cycles, and despite the challenges that we continue to face, despite the numerous difficulties that challenge and undermine our very ability to implement the Paris Accords, to protect our planet, to ensure that global temperatures do not exceed 2.5 degrees or even 3.5 degrees, despite all of the rays and challenges and difficulties, there are some rays of hope. People do cherish their hopes and place their hopes in humanity, because humanity surely can be just to those who are not responsible for the consequences that are producing so much suffering. Surely humanity can find the elements of new solutions. Surely now there is no more time to hesitate, because every government knows what it must do. Every government must work to the extent of its ability to provide those solutions. And all parts of our society, civil society indeed, contribute. They play key roles. In Egypt, we have established ambitious goals that were set forth in the Egyptian National Strategy for Climate Change. And we are determined to accelerate our transition to green adaptation towards the use of green resources and energy through legislation and new laws, as well as new governmental mechanisms to ensure a full green transformation, to contribute to creating an environment that is more favorable for environment-friendly investment in food, in energy, in agriculture. Egypt is now determined to focus on and increase investment in these key green areas. Egypt wants to see a transition to a green economy with low carbon emissions. And that is what we call for, to move to concrete action that has clear, tangible impact in the field. Otherwise, we cannot meet these challenges. The key elements for our success already exist, but we need to be determined. We need a strong will to go further towards a future where we do not have a temperature increase of more than 1.5 degrees. Now, that is the future that meets the hopes and aspirations of all people. I should also say that we must be frank and honest. We must be aware of our capabilities and what we can do. The international community is able to achieve progress, to achieve the goals laid out in Paris. We must be inspired by the trust placed in us when we came together. It is essential that all parties, all countries, but above all, the developing countries on our African continent, their priority must be taken into account. All countries must assume their responsibilities to the degree that they can. We must support the principle of joint but shared responsibility. This will inspire trust in our ability to achieve our goals. Now, that trust, that mutual and multilateral trust, will be the best guarantee of our success, the best guarantee of progress and of achieving our goals. And developed countries must do more to ensure that commitments already assumed are met to face climate change and to support our efforts of adaptation and to face the consequences of climate change in the least developed countries and in developing countries. We must ensure that practical roadmaps are implemented towards a green transition. We need to create an environment that is favorable for developing countries and LDCs in order that they can continue those key efforts. Ladies and gentlemen, your presence today here is the best possible proof of the importance that you place on climate change. I hope that this will also translate into coherence between your positions, and that we will all come together in agreement around implementation. And today, I invite you to send a message to the world, a clear message that contains clear, concrete measures and actions for implementation. I would ask you to take more measures, to do more action, to clarify how you will reduce emissions and launch new ambitious initiatives which will encourage all stakeholders to release adequate funding and to help and facilitate the implementation of all commitments assumed previously. In Egypt, over the coming days, we will be launching new initiatives and measures. The instructions that you will hand down to your negotiators, I hope, will encourage them to demonstrate flexibility in their work. But more than this, for them to remain mindful of the importance of the results that we all want to see at the end of this conference. I'm talking to you of a realistic spirit, closely linked to the clear ideas of what we can do, and we can do great things. We can be ambitious yet realistic. We can together implement the commitments and obligations that we have assumed. And so, from this rostrum, I urge you to become the model that the world hopes for. This will reaffirm our genuine, practical ability to face the challenge of climate change. Climate change will never stop without our intervention. Your Majesty, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, our time here is limited, and we must use every second that we have before the debate is closed. But we have enough time to ensure implementation. There is no time to slip back. There is no space for hesitation. For the sake of future generations, here and now, we are facing a unique historical moment, a last chance to meet our responsibilities. Implementation, implementation, implementation. I wish you every success during your work. May Allah be with you.
اسمحوا لي انا خلصت كلمتي والحقيقه
Thank you. It is critical that we talk of all of the questions that face us, that we freely discuss with all the leaders of the world these major issues. I note that we have prime ministers, princes, great leaders and heads of state who have come together to discuss critically important issues. But allow me also to talk about another question. Of course, we must act. We are urged to act, and much is expected from us, because crisis shakes the entire world. This is another crisis that I want to talk about, the crisis between Russia and Ukraine. And I would like to urge you this is a sincere appeal for this war to end. This war must end. Please allow me to say the following. My country is not one of the strongest economically. We suffered greatly from the COVID-19 pandemic over 2 years. And today we are suffering once again due to this other crisis, this unnecessary war. I imagine, of course, that the entire world is suffering because of the war between Russia and Ukraine. And so I would like to appeal to you, please allow me to say this in all respect. This war must stop. This war and the suffering it has caused must finish. This is a sincere appeal. It is not that I want to play a particular role in this affair, but of course I, like many others, am ready to act to ensure the end of this war, and I am sure that many of you share my opinion, and I believe that all of us believe that we must put an end to this war, and I hope that the spirit of Allah and peace will be with you. Thank you.
Shukran, Siyadat al-Ra'is Abd al-Fattah al-Sisi, Ra'isu.
Thank you. You heard the President of Egypt, President Sisi. And now I would like to invite the Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Antonio Guterres.
President el-Sisi, thank you very much for this wonderful hospitality and for this spectacular organization. COP27, President Shukri, Your Majesties, Excellencies, dear friends. In just days, our planet's population will cross a new threshold. The 8 billionth member of our human family will be born. This milestone puts into perspective what this climate conference is all about. How will we answer when baby 8 billion is old enough to ask, what did you do for our world and for our planet when you had the chance? Excellencies, this UN climate conference is a reminder that the answer is in our hands. And the clock is ticking. We are in the fight of our lives, and we are losing. Greenhouse gas emissions keep growing. Global temperatures keep rising. And our planet is fast approaching tipping points that will make climate chaos irreversible. We are on a highway to climate hell, with our foot still on the accelerator. The war in Ukraine, other conflicts, have caused so much bloodshed and violence and their dramatic impacts all over the world. But we cannot accept that our attention is not focused on climate change. We must, of course, work together to support peace efforts and end the tremendous suffering. But climate change is on a different timeline and a different scale. It is a defining issue of our age. It is the central challenge of our century. It is unacceptable, outrageous, and self-defeating to put it on the back burner. Indeed, many of today's conflicts are linked with growing climate chaos. And the war in Ukraine has exposed the profound risks of our fossil fuel addiction. And today's crisis cannot be an excuse for backsliding or greenwashing. If anything, they are a reason for greater urgency, stronger action, and effective accountability. Excellencies, human activity is the cause of the climate problem, so human action must be the solution. Action to re-establish ambition, and action to rebuild trust, especially between North and South. The science is clear. Any hope of limiting temperature rise to 1.5 degrees means achieving global net zero emissions by 2050. But that 1.5 degree goal is on life support, and the machines are rattling. We are getting dangerously close to the point of no return. And to avoid that dire fate, all G20 countries must accelerate their transition now in these decades. Developed countries must take the lead, but emerging economies are also critical to bending the global emissions curve. Last year in Glasgow, I called for coalitions of support for high-emitting emerging economies to accelerate the transition from coal towards renewables. We are making progress with the Just Energy Transition partnerships, but much more is needed. And that is why at the beginning of COP27, I'm calling for a historic pact between developed and developing economies, and especially developed and emerging economies, a climate solidarity pact. A pact in which all countries make an extra effort to reduce emissions this decade in line with 1.5 degree goal. A pact in which wealthier countries and international financial institutions provide financial and technical assistance to help emerging economies speed their own renewable energy transition. A pact when dependence on fossil fuels and the building of new coal plants, phasing out coal in OECD countries by 2030 and everywhere else by 2040. A pact that will provide universal, affordable, sustainable energy for all. A pact in which developed and emerging economies unite around a common strategy and combine capacities and resources for the benefit of humankind. The two largest economies, the United States and China, have a particular responsibility to join efforts to make this pact a reality. And this is our only hope of meeting our climate goals. Humanity has a choice: cooperate or perish. It is either a climate solidarity pact or a collective suicide pact. Excellence, nous avons aussi désespérément besoin du pôle.
We also need progress in adaptation in order to reinforce our resilience to climate change now and in the future. Today, around 3.5 billion people are living in highly vulnerable countries, vulnerable to climate change. In Glasgow, in developed countries promised to double their contributions between now and 2025. We need a roadmap for implementation also. We need to recognize that this is a first stage. Adaptation resources must exceed 300 million per year by 2030. Half of the climate change funding must be focused on adaptation. International financial institutions and global development banks need to change their economic models, and they need to do their share to boost adaptation models. They must serve as tools to lever more financial resources to serve efforts to fight climate change. Countries and communities must have access to that funding, which must be funneled to key initiatives such as through the Adaptation Pipeline Accelerator.
We must acknowledge a harsh truth. There is no adapting to a growing number of catastrophic events causing enormous suffering around the world. The deadly impacts of climate change are here and now. Loss and damage can no longer be swept under the rug. It is a moral imperative. It is a fundamental question of international solidarity and climate justice. Those who contributed least to the climate crisis are reaping the whirlwind sown by others. And many are blindsided by impacts for which they had no warning or means of preparation. This is why I'm calling for a universal early warning system coverage within 5 years. And it is why I am asking that all governments tax the windfall profits of fossil fuel companies. Let's redirect that money to people struggling with rising food and energy prices and to countries suffering loss and damage caused by the climate crisis. On addressing loss and damage, this COP must agree on a clear time-bound roadmap reflective of the scale and urgency of the challenge. And this roadmap must deliver effective institutional arrangements for financing. Getting concrete results on loss and damage is a litmus test of the commitment of the governments to the success of COP27. Excellencies and friends, the good news is that we know what to do, and we have the financial and technological tools to get the job done. It is time for nations to come together for implementation. It is time for international solidarity across the board. Solidarity that respects all human rights and guarantees, a safe space for environmental defenders and all actors in society to contribute to our climate response. Let's not forget that the war on nature is itself a massive violation of human rights. We need all hands on deck for faster, bolder climate action. A window of opportunity remains open, but only a narrow shaft of light remains. The global climate fight will be won or lost in this crucial decade on our watch. And one thing is certain, those that give up are sure to lose. So let's fight together and let's win. For the 8 billion members of our human family and for generations to come. Thank you.
COP27. Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt. Together for implementation.
Shukran للسيد أنطونيو غوتيريش الأمين العام.
Thank you, Antonio Guterres, UN Secretary General. I would like to welcome Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, who is the President of the UAE.
Excellency, my dear friend, Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, your majesties, your excellencies, Mr. COP President, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, Your Excellency President, we are with you in what you said. Indeed, we need peace, we need dialogue, and we need the war to stop. First of all, I would like to thank the Arab Republic of Egypt and the Secretariat of the UNFCCC for organizing and hosting the 27th session of the Conference of the Parties, COP27. Here we are gathered today at a critical moment for our planet. Our world is facing intricate and complex challenges, including climate change, which has become so impactful on stability and security around the world. And since we only have one planet, it is essential that we bring together our efforts in order to address this challenge by engaging in climate action, which we see as an opportunity for innovation, for solution making, and economic diversity. Ladies and gentlemen, the UAE is known as a responsible supplier of energy and will continue to play this role for as long as the world needs oil and gas. And given that geology has its own logic, well, oil and gas, ladies and gentlemen, in the UAE is among the least carbon intensive oil and gas around the world. And we will focus on lowering carbon emissions emanating from this sector. And this is not a new effort that we're going to undertake. Our founding father, Sheikh Zayed, may his soul rest in peace, has instructed that gas burning should stop for decades and instated the pillars of sustainability for the UAE in order to preserve the environment and natural resources. And as we follow in the footsteps of the founding father, for decades we have been working towards diversifying our economy and to build capacities in renewables and clear energies in order to promote economic and social development in a sustainable way. And the UAE has been the first country in the region that announced a strategic initiative for carbon neutrality by 2050. And we've launched just a few days ago a partnership agreement with the United States for investing $100 billion and to produce 100 gigawatts of clean energy in various parts of the world. This initiative, among others, create new sectors, new skill sets, and new jobs. And it also helps the spark of hope to remain and to continue in as far as we want to keep tabs on global warming. Ladies and gentlemen, the UAE continues its efforts to build bridges of cooperation and communication with members of the international community. And as we prepare for COP28 in the city of Dubai, Expo, in year 2023, we will be focusing on supporting the implementation of the outcomes of the previous COPs and also to make sure that the first global stocktake in the wake of the Paris Agreement. We will also focus on engaging everybody, all stakeholders, with proper and adequate representation of women, and also making sure that youth from around the world will partake and also further promote their enthusiasm for sustainable solutions. We are pleased to address an open invitation to all to cooperate in finding practical solutions that contribute to addressing the issue of loss and damage, as well as create new opportunities for sustainable economic development for humanity all over the world. Brothers and sisters, I would like to renew my expression of thanks to our brothers and sisters in Egypt, and I wish you and us all successful proceedings and successful efforts, because the risks and dangers around climate change target everybody with no exception. And because the future of our children and the children of our children will hinge on the steps that we'll take today. Thank you. Thank you, Your Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan, President of the United Arab Emirates. We have seen throughout this year weather disasters and conditions that have had a negative impact everywhere in the world and on all species. And so nature is telling us that something is amiss, and everything happened in just 1 year. Please watch the video.
Once upon a time, in this land of wonders, there lived the mighty people of the Old Kingdom. Evidence of extreme weather events, such as droughts and erosions, lines their temple walls. The arid weather caused a decline in crop yield and a squabble over resources, challenging every element of ancient Egyptian life and rattling every emotion.
The number of weather-related disasters has increased fivefold.
Hundreds of thousands of people across five provinces have been left without power.
Today's IPCC report.
I am confusion, shock, disillusionment, unexpected, sudden and devastating. I am overcome, speechless. I am the bitter truth.
This is a story of an industry in action.
Where did we go wrong?
As any human being, when I get ill somewhere in my body, say my back, it echoes somewhere else. That's because all the organs of our body are interconnected. Much like the human body, our planet is a dynamic system made of several components such as air, water, land, glaciers, vegetation, animals, marine life, and humans. Their interaction is what makes our planet the perfect home for us. Any disruption to this delicate equilibrium threatens life on Earth. Not just for us, the lives of all our other neighbors with whom we share this home. Our home of over 4.5 billion years is covered by an atmosphere, a roof that keeps us warm and protects us from overheating. Fossil fuels and gas emissions get trapped under our roof, causing an increase in temperature. In other words, global warming, which is behind the extreme weather events that are increasing in both number and size. Winters are colder, summers are hotter, but you see, Earth always adapts to restore its balance. Earth will move on, but without us.
I am anger, hostile and enraged. Look at them. These are your most vulnerable. I am the wrath.
Eh bien, il y a eu une tempête. C'était une catastrophe. J'ai tout perdu. J'ai perdu ma maison. J'ai perdu des amis. Ma femme est traumatisée, moi je suis traumatisée, ma petite aussi.
Did the latest headlines distract you from thinking about what has happened to them? After you switch the channel? I look like terror and destruction.
يا صاحي البيوت طبعا تأثرت بالمياه، يعني مجرد ما خشت المويه البيوت استسلمت ووقعت.
لا لا لا، حكاية شهريا وتقريبا ثلاثة شهور أنا ما دخلت لا قريش أحمر.
I am the darkness that devours you, your flaming blood. I am sadness, sorrow and grief. Stop, take a closer look. This is a person just like you, with the same needs as you. Are their futures not as bright as yours? Their dreams not as big?
In Selab Jagarasan, a goat may pani a chosen, a school, Budia, Sana Ghar Kacha, Budia, I assigned a tent mera Aramuta, I assigned a school, Golian, a tent on Mara, and Utesan, Barunda.
I stand for 3 billion people who can't feed their kids. This is your pain, your trees, your home, your school, your child, your doll. I am the wounds that can't heal. I am the pain with no end. I am despair, agony. I am the hurt everywhere. The screams, the cries, the anguish.
Η φωτιά πάντα αφήνει κόστος, είτε ψυχολογικό κόστος, είτε οικονομικό, κάτι θα σου αφήσει, κάτι θα σου πάρει. Πάντα αλλάζει η ζωή των ανθρώπων. Αλλιώς ήμασταν πριν 30 χρόνια και αλλιώς θα είμαστε μετά από 40 χρόνια.
Επειδή όμως ήταν αποπνικτική η κατάσταση, ο γιος μου φοβήθηκε από μένα μήπως πάθω κάτι και λέει, πατέρα, πάμε να φύγουμε.
Are their communities not as deserving? This is the water you have stopped from flowing. The pollution you brought yourselves and others. I am suffocation, congested and off balance. These are the gifts you have plundered, the cultivated land you have soiled.
Are you okay? Yeah, I'll jump on one. Okay. Dad, I love you.
I am your heart. Shattered in pieces. These are your slain men and women. The gloom, disappointment, the isolation. I am those you have made to weep. When will it be enough? I am the drought where water once flowed. Your rising blood pressure flooding your ghost lines. I am the threat, the fear that lurks in the shadow, the threat to your future. I am endangerment.
خلال رحلتي في التصوير ابتديت الاحظ اماكن اختفت، اماكن منسوب المياه فيها بيعلى، منسوب المياه فيها بيقل.
اسكندريه موطني، بقالنا سنين بنتكلم عن تغيير في المناخ، الان الاوان ان العالم ينظر نظره جاده للموضوع ده.
لما بسمع ان اسكندريه ممكن تغرق في يوم من الايام قلبي بيتقبض جدا يعني.
I am worried. Do I make you nervous, insecure? I will be nostalgia. I am the ticking clock. Tick-tock. The time you don't have, the race you must win. Where will you go? What will you see? What will you eat? Tick-tock. I am the terror of an uncertain future. Tick-tock. And I put all your plans at risk. Tick-tock. I'm anxiety. The what now? Tick-tock. Your body in panic mood, your rapid pulse, the fight or flight. And I cascade.
La veneziano per me è Venezia, il centro del mondo. Centro del mondo, città unica, inimitabile. E ripeto, pensare che sparisca una città, monumento del genere, unico al mondo, è sì che facciano tutto quello che è nelle loro possibilità per salvare Venezia e a sto punto non solo, perché tutte le città che sono in riva al mare hanno lo stesso problema che a Venezia. Please save our city.
His city is your city. I need less talk, more action.
All this is not without hope. That's the beauty of our planet. It keeps giving us chances. How do we fix this? Together. Governments need to put in place policies and regulations to guide us in the right direction. Businesses, need to transform the life cycle of products. Individuals need to consume more ethically. In Paris, in 2015, we promised to keep global warming beneath the 1.5 degrees limit. Today, we gather to reaffirm our commitment. We can do this.
1.5 is what we need to survive.
To limit warming to 1.5 degrees.
1.5 degrees.
We need to stick 1.5 degrees.
هدف الواحد ونص درجة مئوية صار أمراً حتمياً لا يحتمل التأخير.
I am hope. Heals, what brings you together, found where the solutions are.
Vertical farming is a very new, promising technology, but there's very little experience in how to run, operate, get a commercially successful vertical farm.
I am your pride, your potential. I am the smile on his face. The butterfly is in your stomach. The conviction that you are more powerful than you think. I am your actions that determine their future. I am triumphant. I am the change. I am the love that nourishes you, the passion that drives you. I am that feeling of home, your shelter, the roof that protects you. I energize, I empower you. I come in the shape of implementation. I could be measured. I sound like communication, awareness, commitment. I am the love you find every day and everywhere. You feel me in the oceans, the soil, the mountains, the sky, and the forests. They say I'm blind, leave no one behind. Celebrate our differences. I am despair, but I'm also joy. I am the fear, but also the hope. I am the problem, but I could be the solution. We are the emotions that need no language. When Earth aches, we fall. When she blossoms, we flourish. This is the track we must reverse. The order we must restore. Which brings us back to our story. It was when the ancient Egyptians mobilized and adapted that they were able to mitigate the challenges. They got smart and came up with sustainable ways that are ahead of even our times. And so they left us a tale of hope and wisdom about the importance of going the way of nature and on its power to heal us all. Climate changes all of us.
منذ العام الماضي والدورة السادسة والعشرين من قمة المناخ COP.
Thank you. Last year we had COP26. But since then, climate change has accelerated. We have seen many serious weather events in the past year. And now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Macky Sall, the President of Senegal and President of the African Union.
Excellencies, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, President of the Arab Republic of Egypt, Majesty, Highnesses, Ladies and Gentlemen, Heads of State and Government, UN Secretary General, President of COP27, Ladies and Gentlemen, on behalf of Africa, I would very much like to thank you and indeed congratulate you, dear brother, President el-Sisi, for your very kind invitation and the very warm welcome that has been extended to us as we arrived in Egypt. I think this is something which testifies to the friendship between the Arab world and the African world. Everything has been said so far on the climate emergency that is bringing us all together today. Scientific papers and studies have on more than one occasion alerted us to this. Every single day we are seeing extreme weather events, testimony to climate change. Now, more than ever, we must act to save our planet. We have to implement the Paris Agreement. Africa is deeply attached to doing this with our Great Green Wall, which is bringing together 11 African states in the Sahel-Sahara region. We have many activities to restore land and to reforest, as well as to create forestry activities, livestock activities. Ladies and gentlemen, although we contribute to the tune of less than 4% in terms of greenhouse gases, Africa is behind low carbon development. We're fighting for climate resilience. We think this has to be a goal so that we achieve carbon neutrality by a reasonable time frame. We are in favor of green transition, a just, fair, and equitable transition, instead of decisions being taken that harm our development processes, including universal access to electricity. 600 million Africans are still deprived of that. With the Congo Basin forests, our Congo also hosts a quarter of what still remains in terms of tropical forests for our planet. It means that we host one of the rare green lungs of our planet. And of course, all these are able to sequester carbon. We need to move ahead to adapt to climate change. We are certainly bearing the brunt and the cost of this. We are developing green development, and very often we use debt to do this. The implementation of adaptation is something that should be funded by grants and donations as per agreed conventions. We have our adaptation fund, and we have partner countries, and together in September last, we launched a call for action to implement the program to speed up adaptation in Africa. And I'd very much like to publicly thank European states here and the foundation who were partners, who contributed to the tune of 90 million euros for that, to give us, it's a leverage in that we have been able to use in order to get adaptation funds. Accumulated funding for adaptation anticipated before 2030 will unfortunately account for less than a quarter of the estimated needs that Africa has as part of their NDCs nationally. Sharm el-Sheikh, I believe, both for developed and developing countries, offers us an opportunity to either make history or, if you like, be a victim of history. Make history by shouldering and honoring our commitments, including the 100 billion. Bearing the brunt of history, because we don't share our responsibilities, there have to be shared and differentiated responsibilities whereby those who pollute the most should pay the most in order to get our planet off this track of climate crisis. We have come as Africans to Sharm el-Sheikh in order to save our planet. We are determined to make history rather than simply be victims, passive onlookers of history. Together with our partners, we will do all we can to ensure that the Sharm el-Sheikh COP is not simply a business as usual, bearing in mind, and we've just seen the video, how this hangs over our humanity, but act for future generations as well as current generations. We cannot stay within the realm of promises, but have to move to action to solve and save our planet, our common home. Thank you.
شكراً للسيد الرئيس ماكي سال رئيس دولة السنغال ورئيس
Thank you, President of Senegal, Mr. Macky Sall, and President of the African Union. Thank you for your statement. I'd now like to give the floor to Baroness Michel Shafik, who is the Director of the London School of Economics.
I am honored to speak here today in the country of my birth, a country that has been the cradle of human civilization for millennia, on a topic that will determine the future of human civilization and whether it lasts for more millennia. I'm an economist who's worked on development and environment issues for several decades, and I wanted to speak to you today about the economy of the future. But before doing that, let me start with a story from the past. Over 3,000 years ago, a different kind of climate change, not caused by greenhouse gases, but by volcanic eruptions, changed weather patterns in the world, resulting in persistent droughts that caused famines and political unrest in ancient Egypt. The pharaohs of the Ptolemaic dynasty, such as Cleopatra, went to great lengths to adapt, transferring grain from productive regions to drought-plagued areas, opening up grain stores, crossbreeding cattle to develop heat-resistant animals, and providing tax relief. These foresighted efforts by the pharaohs managed to prolong the Egyptian empire for a half a century more. But ultimately, one of the greatest empires that the world has ever seen collapsed because of the effects of climate change. The difference between then and now is that we are the cause of today's climate change, and we have the means to stop it by changing our economy. So what could the economy of the future look like? We have a choice. It could be one based on familiar technologies, markets, and institutions. We could continue with polluted air and water, where our children suffer from respiratory diseases and 8 to 10 million people die each year from air pollution, where our economies are struck by frequent shocks caused by unpredictable weather changes, which cause catastrophic losses, where people have to move across borders as their livelihoods are destroyed by rising sea levels, persistent droughts, and rising temperatures, and one where the natural world continues to diminish. I can also paint a very different picture of the economy of the future, one in which we make the needed investments and create cities in which we can move and live and breathe and thrive. One in which the food we eat regenerates the earth rather than depletes it, where our economies continue to grow, and especially in poor countries, livelihoods and living standards continue to improve, but where this growth is greener, more stable, and where human well-being is enhanced by supporting and protecting nature and the ecosystems on which all life depends. Just as we had an industrial revolution that transformed our economies in the 19th century, and a green revolution which transformed agriculture in the 20th century, we need a green industrial revolution in the 21st centuries that makes our economies more sustainable. That low-carbon economy is one where there are huge opportunities for innovation and new technologies and a more attractive way of life. So how do we get this economy of the future? We know it will take a great deal of investment. Meeting the climate goals of the Paris Agreement requires investment on the scale of about $4 to $6 trillion per year globally. We know we are in difficult economic times with war, recession, and inflation. Where will the money come from for this new investment? In tough times, we need to use our limited resources most efficiently. And given the history of climate change, we need an appropriate balance between responsibility and resources. And as we learned during the COVID pandemic, when we try and tackle global problems from national silos, it is more expensive and less effective. So we need to do this together. Public sector investment will play a key role in many parts, particularly in the advanced economies. Despite current fiscal constraints, these investments can be financed because they will generate positive returns. For developing countries, many of which face high debt burdens and a high cost of capital, we need to enable the multilateral development banks to massively increase concessional finance to make clean investment cheaper than dirty ones. The actions needed are laid out very clearly in the report of the independent high-level expert group on climate finance chaired by Vera Songway and Nick Stern that will be launched this week. Lending by the multilateral development banks needs to increase at least threefold, supported by more capital and more imaginative ways of using their balance sheets, as has been recently suggested in a report to the G20. This lending needs to be supported so that the big emitters are compensated for incurring costs for producing global public goods, and so that adaptation funding is provided on generous terms for vulnerable countries where loss and damage is high. Such an approach would accelerate the green industrial and agricultural revolution using the most efficient financing channels we have for the world as a whole. And of course, the private sector has an important role to play. Governments can de-risk the regulatory environment by providing clear policy frameworks and guarantees. Development banks can provide platforms that crowd in private finance, creating leverage or sharing risks around first losses and frontier projects. And all sources of financing need to play their part at this moment to stretch beyond their comfort zones if we're going to make progress at the scale and speed that we need. I applaud the Egyptian government's focus on adaptation and Africa at this COP. Africa is responsible for only 1% of the stock of global emissions, but will be hardest hit by climate change. That cannot be right. At the same time, many African countries are rich in sunshine, wind, rivers, and forests. With support at a lower cost of capital, they could leapfrog the dirty energy systems of the past. And if we create a better carbon market, that could provide a huge source of income for countries rich in carbon sinks. The green industrial revolution could be the new growth story for Africa. So, the economy of the future is our choice. We face a classic intertemporal investment problem. incur some investment costs now with high returns later, or opt for inaction or not enough action, but incur very high costs and risks later. Even if you don't take into account future generations, which make these arguments much, much stronger, it seems to me that the choice is clear. Climate change and biodiversity loss are here, and we are already suffering the consequences, as the film we just saw showed so clearly. Unlike the pharaohs, we can overcome this climate change by choosing a different economy for the future. Thank you very much.
شكرا للبارونيس مينوش شفيق رئيسة جامعة لندن للقاء.
I would like to thank Baroness Minouche Shafiq of the London School of Economics. Young people are the force behind the future, and they offer humanity a bright future. We will now listen to a young lady who has adopted a cause on behalf of all of humanity and has worked to fight climate change herself. I would like to give the floor to Ms. Leah Namugerwa, a climate activist from Uganda.
I greet you all who are here for a good cause. Leaders who are working tirelessly to save our dear planet, I salute you. Individuals like Leah Namugerwa, who are doing whatever it takes to see that life continues on our dear planet, I salute you. And those who are still denying and have not yet believed that the climate crisis is affecting us, we have stories to share. I and many young people were robbed from our future. We've been forced to grow, to act, to think like adults, because we cannot watch as our future is shut, our dreams put to an end, our home, Mother Earth, burning, heating in drought, and we do nothing. When I was 14 years old, I saw landslides killing so many people due to harsh weather conditions. These images have disturbed me and cannot allow me to rest until something is done about the changing climate. Individually, everyone has a role to play to save our dear planet. At such a tender age, I started a project called Birthday Trees when I was turning 15 years of age. I plant trees on people's birthdays as one of the ways to fight climate change. I have a goal of planting 1 million trees and more. What is your goal? It is the rule of nature living for others. Because plants do not eat their own food. Rivers do not drink their own water. I don't believe it is justice to the young generation when our rivers and lakes are polluted. I don't see justice when big polluters are untouchable. Is it justice for the world leaders to choose profits over lives? COP27 has been nicknamed the African COP. If COP27 is to truly deliver, we must face some real truth. Some truth that we have faced decades of inaction from world leaders. Some truth that the world is in a state of emergency because of fossil fuels. Some truth that Africa contributes less than 4% of the carbon emissions, but we suffer the most. The future is at stake, mostly young children. We're not sure whether we are heard when we speak or we're just ignored. But let the African COP be a different COP. Let the African COP listen to the biggest stakeholders. Let the African COP be an action COP. Politicians, when you stand up to talk, my generation requests that speak like there is an emergency. Speak like you are not barren. Act like you have an access on Earth, because this is the only planet where we are going to carry on your legacy as your children. Men in office, how are you going to be remembered? Do you wish to be remembered as one who did a lot of nothing while in power? Fellow delegates on the conservation front, the world is looking upon us to come up with an ambitious action plan that majorly benefits people. A sustainable plan that predicts a bright future. The time to force action is right now, right here at the African COP. I believe we can do this together. Thank you.
شكراً ليانا موغيرا ناشطة المناخ من أوغندا.
I would like to thank Ms. Lia Namugera, climate activist from Uganda. Dear hosts, ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to welcome the 2007 Nobel Prize winner, fighter for the climate and for Earth, Vice President of the United States, Mr. Al Gore.
Your Royal Highnesses, Your Majesties, Heads of State, Excellencies, Ladies and Gentlemen, distinguished guests, it is a great honor to be able to play a part in this opening ceremony of the 27th Conference of the Parties. Mr. President, thank you. Mr. Secretary General, thank you for your leadership of the entire world. We are all here today because we continue to use the thin blue shell of atmosphere surrounding our planet as an open sewer. Today, as every day, we are spewing 162 million tons of man-made heat-trapping global warming pollution into the sky. It adds up and accumulates and lingers there. On average, each molecule lingers 100 years, and the accumulated amount now traps as much extra heat as would be released by 600,000 Hiroshima-class atomic bombs exploding every day on our planet. That's why we're seeing these disasters. And the pattern is very clear. It's getting steadily worse. We have a credibility problem, all of us. We're talking, and we're starting to act, but we're not doing enough. It is a choice to continue this pattern of destructive behavior. We have other choices. In my faith tradition, I learned a teaching that is common to all three of the Abrahamic religions, that God has set before humanity a choice between blessings and curses, between life and death. We face that choice today. We can continue the culture of death that surrounds our addiction to fossil fuels by digging up dead life forms from eons ago and burning them recklessly in ways that create more death, including 8.7 million people every year that die from the air pollution, principally caused by the burning of fossil fuels. The curses that we are continuing to choose are ever more apparent. We saw them on that amazingly powerful film, one-third of Pakistan underwater, 1,700 people killed. A heat wave in China that lasted 70 days with the heat above 40 degrees, 104 Fahrenheit over a vast area of China. Stronger storms, bigger downpours, rain bombs, worse floods. Another million displaced in Nigeria 2 weeks ago. Another million in Chad a few days after that. The Nile Delta being salinated, just as Hannibal's fields were salted. We are causing the salting of the greatest agricultural area in Egypt, as well as in the Mekong Delta and elsewhere. Droughts are drying up the mighty Mississippi River in my country, the Tigris and the Euphrates in the cradle of civilization, the Po River in Italy, the Loire in France, the Rhine in Germany. All over the world, the greatest reservoirs in North America, Lake Mead and Lake Powell, are reaching what is called Deadpool status. Starvation and famine in the Horn of Africa, devastation in Madagascar. And the areas of our world that are presently considered by doctors uninhabitable because of the combination of heat and humidity are relatively small today, but they are due to expand to the point where experts are predicting as many as 1 billion climate migrants crossing international borders in the balance of this century. Think of the millions that are crossing borders now and the xenophobia and authoritarian populism that is caused by a large surge of refugees. And then imagine, if you will, what 1 billion climate refugees would do. It would end the possibilities of self-governance. We have to act. We know that tragically, across the nations of Africa, these impacts are even worse, and in the Pacific Islands and elsewhere, and the poor suffer the most. The late Archbishop Desmond Tutu said, climate change is the apartheid of our times. We don't have to choose curses. We can choose blessings, including the blessings of renewable energy. We are now in the early stages of a sustainability revolution that has the magnitude of the Industrial Revolution and the speed of the digital revolution. If we invest in it and stop subsidizing the culture of death, we can save ourselves. Dollar for dollar, each dollar spent in renewable energy creates 3 times as many jobs as dollars spent in fossil energy. And this sustainability revolution is massively deflationary at just the time when the world is trying to find new ways to battle inflation. The International Energy Agency has called solar energy the cheapest energy in the entire history of the world. And Africa can be the renewable energy superpower. Africa has 40% of the entire world's global potential for renewables. The potential for solar and wind in Africa is 400 times larger than their total fossil fuel reserves. And these are real possibilities. This is not pie in the sky. If you look at all of the new electricity generation installed worldwide last year, 90% of it was renewable because it is cheaper almost everywhere. And in 2 years, it will be cheaper in 100% of the world. But it is not enough to simply increase our support for clean energy if we are simultaneously backtracking on our commitments against developing and financing fossil fuels. The world's leading scientists and energy experts have told us that any new fossil fuel development is incompatible with 1.5 degrees as the limit to the temperature increase. Mr. Secretary General, you said we are on a highway to climate hell. We need to take our foot off the gas. We need to obey the first law of holes. When you're in one, stop digging. We have to stop making this crisis worse. We must see the so-called dash for gas for what it really is, a dash down a bridge to nowhere, leaving the countries of the world facing climate chaos and billions in stranded assets, especially here in Africa. At a time of turbulence in the global energy markets, the wealthy nations of the world should not confuse the short term with the long term, and should not be fooled by the absolute need to backfill the shortage of fossil energy caused by the cruel and evil war launched by Russia in Ukraine as an excuse for locking in long-term commitments to even more dependence and addiction on fossil fuels. We have to move beyond the era of fossil fuel colonialism. And that's what it is. The dash for gas in Africa is a dash for gas to be sent to wealthy countries. We have to remove the barriers to the trillions needed for climate finance. And the scale of what is needed can only be provided by the private sector. I support governments paying money for loss and damage and adaptation, but let's be very clear that that's a matter of billions or tens of billions. We need $4.5 trillion per year to make this transition, and that can only come by unlocking private access to private capital. In the United States and in Canada, if you look at all of the financing of renewable energy, 96% of it comes from the private market. If you look at Africa, much lower amounts overall, but what percentage of it comes from private markets? Not 96%, 14%. 86% comes from governments. Why is that? Because, for example, if you want to build a solar field in Nigeria, even though it's profitable, you have to pay interest rates that are 7 times higher than the interest rates paid by OECD countries. That is unjust. It is insane. That is what the World Bank and the multilateral development banks are supposed to address. We need to reconvene Bretton Woods and completely revamp and reform the World Bank system and make access to private capital available for developing countries. This is a moment for a global epiphany. It is not time for moral cowardice and reckless indifference to the future of humanity. If you want an example of reckless indifference, just recall the banker who said earlier this year in discussing the impacts of the climate crisis, "Who cares?" When he was fired, it reminded me of the famous writer who said that in the highest reaches of business and politics, a gaffe is often when someone accidentally tells the truth. The truth is that all of us have limitations and weaknesses and vulnerabilities, but as human beings, we also have the God-given ability to rise above those limitations. The greatest leader of my country, Abraham Lincoln, once said, "The occasion is piled high with difficulty, and we must rise with the occasion. As our case is new, we must think anew and act anew. We must disenthrall ourselves, and then we shall save our country." And that is the way we can save our world. More is needed, but we have the basis for hope. Just days ago, the people of Brazil chose to stop the destruction of the Amazon. Earlier this year, the people of Australia chose to start leading the renewable energy revolution. Earlier this year, the people of my country chose leaders who enacted at long last the biggest and most ambitious climate legislation in the history of the world. The world has passed and enacted the Kigali Amendment. We have the basis for hope. If we actually do reach true net zero, the scientists tell us temperatures will stop going up with a lag time of as little as 3 to 5 years. And if we stay at true net zero, half of all of the man-made CO2 will fall out of the atmosphere in as little as 25 to 30 years. But we have to choose blessings instead of curses. We have to choose life over death. If we are truly to make this COP the one that drives implementation of the pledges made in Glasgow, We must equip ourselves with every tool and resource to facilitate our path to true net zero and work together to drive impact and increase accountability. I want to applaud the Secretary General for making transparency around these net zero goals a priority. And I'm proud that 2 days from now, Climate Trace, a nonprofit coalition of artificial intelligence experts and data scientists and researchers and NGOs, will announce the first inventory of site-specific facility sources of greenhouse gas pollution, the most detailed inventory ever assembled that can be used to identify exactly where all this pollution is coming from. There is a path that we can make from here to a future with hope. As a final point, I started by saying that we have a credibility problem, but we also have the ability to address it. And if anyone doubts that we can summon the political will to do what is necessary and to save our future, always remember that political will is itself a renewable resource. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Former Vice President of the United States, Al Gore. Peace Nobel Prize laureate. Now, please allow me to call on Ms. Veronica Eyring of the University of Bremen.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, distinguished excellencies, recent climate change is unprecedented. We all know and feel this, but still, atmospheric levels of greenhouse gases reach new record highs every year. Atmospheric concentration of CO2 has risen to 416 parts per million today, being now 50% above the pre-industrial level. As a consequence, global warming has reached 1.1 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels in 2020. This is already very close to the Paris Agreement to limit global warming to near 1.5 degrees. The speed of this warming is rapid, and it is unprecedented in more than 2,000 years. Over the history of our planet, changes in global temperature were caused by natural events like volcanic eruptions, the sun's activity, and orbital cycles. But the warming we observe since 1850 is not caused by natural events. It is caused by human activities emitting CO2 and other greenhouse gases, also causing widespread, rapid, and intensifying climate changes across the entire Earth system, which will increase with any additional further warming. In every region of the world, we are seeing out-of-control climate impacts, with extreme events becoming more frequent and more severe. Many of the recent extremes would have been highly unlikely to occur without human-induced climate change. Across sectors and regions, the most vulnerable people and ecosystems are disproportionately affected by these changes. The rise in extremes has led to some irreversible impacts, as nature and humans are pushed beyond their ability to adapt. So what are our possible futures? These are the five CO2 emission scenarios assessed by the IPCC that depend on the level of climate change mitigation. Two low scenarios in blue, where CO2 emissions immediately decline, two high scenarios in red, where they continue to rise, and an intermediate. And these are the corresponding temperature projections for each scenario. As you can see, only in the lowest emission scenario in the upper left, global warming projections stay close to 1.5 degrees by the end of the century, while in all others, projected warming is much higher. These climate projections provide a clear signal to COP27. To limit to 1.5 degrees, we need to cut CO2 emissions by around 45% by 2030. This is already in 8 years, and they must decline further to achieve net zero by 2050, followed by negative CO2 emissions throughout the rest of the century. Immediate, deep, and sustained reductions of methane and other greenhouse gases are also required. Otherwise, limiting warming to 1.5 degrees will be beyond reach. But we are not on track. Not with policies that were implemented by December 2020, not with COP26 pledges, and not with policies currently in place that, with no additional action, are projected to lead to a global warming of 2.8 degrees. Distinguished Excellencies, this is falling far short of the Paris goals with no credible pathway to 1.5 degree in place. Much stronger mitigation measures are needed to keep warming below 1.5 degrees, even for limiting it to 2 degrees. This demands immediate, critical steps to shift societies, economies, and technologies towards net zero emissions across all sectors and all regions. It requires a systematic change, turning away from fossil fuel use, from exploitation of natural resources, and from unsustainable agriculture, forestry, and other land use. The next few years are critical. We have the know-how to take meaningful, more decisive climate actions. Creating new economic opportunities for zero-carbon technology and conserving, protecting, and restoring ecosystems. Now is the time. Climate scientists around the whole world work together to provide you with this robust information on climate change and pathways for climate action. Comprehensive and long-term observation provide us with unprecedented and compelling information about the Earth system. Climate models provide us with robust information about future climate changes and impacts on natural and human systems. Based on this research, the IPCC 6 assessment report assessed the latest science on climate change. The cumulative scientific evidence is unequivocal. Climate change is a threat to human well-being and planetary health. Any further delay in collective global action on adaptation and mitigation will miss a brief and rapidly closing window of opportunity to secure a livable and sustainable future for all. To avoid a climate catastrophe, we need urgent, large-scale transformation of our industrial energy and transport systems and our whole way of life. A shift from exploitation to cooperation with the environment towards nature-based solutions that help restore ecosystems and preserve biodiversity. Only then we can create a sustainable and climate-resilient world. The time for action is now, here at COP27. This is a global problem which requires action from all countries of the world, from all of you working together. Dear ladies and gentlemen, distinguished excellencies, your choices made in the coming 2 weeks matter for many generations to come. We, the whole world, count on you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Veronica Eyring, head of the assessment and analysis of the Earth ecosystem at the University of Bremen. And now, please welcome with me Ms. Mia Motley, the Prime Minister of Barbados.
Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, permit me to thank you, Your Excellency, President el-Sisi, for your wonderful hospitality and for all courtesies extended to us. And I want to congratulate Simon Steele, a son of the Caribbean, of whom we're very proud, in his new role as Executive Director. I came here to say a few things, but the chorus that we've had from this stage has been clear. I don't need to repeat that we have the power of choice. Every speaker on this platform has done that. I don't need to repeat that this is the COP that needs action. All of us, as a chorus, have said that. I don't need to repeat the horror and the devastation wreaked upon this earth over the course of the last 12 months since we met in Glasgow, whether the apocalyptic floods in Pakistan, or the heat waves from Europe to China, or indeed in the last few days in my own region, the devastation caused in Belize by Tropical Storm Lisa, or the torrential floods a few days ago in St. Lucia. We don't need to repeat it, because a picture spoke 1,000 words earlier. But what we do need to do is to understand why we are not moving any further. 1.5 to stay alive cannot be that mantra, and I take no pride in being associated with having to repeat it over and over and over. We have the collective capacity to transform. We're in the country that built pyramids. We know what it is to remove slavery from our civilization. We know what it is to be able to find a vaccine within 2 years when a pandemic hits us. We know what it is to put a man on the moon, and now we put in rover on Mars. We know what it is. But the simple political will that is necessary, not just to come here and make promises, but to deliver on them and to make a definable difference in the lives of the people who we have a responsibility to serve, seems still not to be capable of being produced. I ask us how many more and how much more must happen. And I say so because there is no simplicity in it. We get it. I come from a small island state that has high ambition, but that is not able to deliver on that high ambition because the global industrial strategy that we have has fault lines in it. Our ability to access electric cars, or our ability to access batteries or photovoltaic panels, are constrained by those countries that have the dominant presence and can produce for themselves, but the global south remains at the mercy of the global north on these issues. But it isn't only in that. We heard Al Gore just now speak about the difference in the cost of capital to those of us in the global south. And I ask us, how many more people must speak before those of us who have the capacity to instruct our directors at the World Bank. Is that called the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development only for the 20th century? At the IMF, which has at least has been trying more than the World Bank, how many more countries must falter, particularly in a world that is now suffering the consequences of war and inflation, and countries therefore are unable to meet the challenges of finding the necessary resources to finance their way to net zero. This world looks still too much like it did when it was part of an imperialistic empire. The global north borrows between interest rates of between 1 to 4%, the global south of 14%. And then we wonder why the just energy partnerships are not working. Similarly, we ask ourselves if countries that want to finance their way to net zero and want to do the right thing can't get the critical supplies, will they not have to rely again on natural gas as that clean bridge? This is the bald reality. And we have come here to ask us to open our minds to different possibilities. We believe that we have a plan. We believe that there can be the establishment of a climate mitigation trust that unlocks $5 trillion of private sector savings if we can summon the will to use the SDRs, 500 billion of SDRs, special drawing rights, in a way that unlocks the private sector capital. We believe that requires a change in the attitude of Congress. Because the agreement that establishes the International Monetary Fund requires 85% to change that agreement. And if the United States government has 17% of the quota, then it can't be done, Mr. Gore, without your Congress. Similarly, we accept that there was and must be a commitment to unlocking concessional funding for climate-vulnerable countries. There is no way that developing countries who have been graduated can fight this battle without access to concessional funding. We heard it on this stage from the head of my old alma mater at LSE. We believe that it is critical that we address the issue of loss and damage. The talk must come to an end. And I'd like to salute Denmark and Belgium and Scotland for their own modest ways of trying to accept the precepts and principles of loss and damage as critical and as morally just. But for loss and damage to work, we believe that it can't only be an issue of asking state parties to do the right thing, although they must. But we believe that the non-state actors and the stakeholders, the oil and gas companies, and those who facilitate them need to be brought into a special convocation between now and COP28. How do companies make $200 billion in profits in the last 3 months and not expect to contribute at least 10 cents in every dollar of profit to a loss and damage fund? This is what our people expect. And I ask us, as we reflect on what a loss and damage fund can look like and who should access it, that we convene a special convocation that doesn't only involve state parties, but non-state actors such as the same companies. We believe as well that the time has come for the introduction of natural disaster and pandemic clauses in our debt instruments. I have said that if Barbados is hit tomorrow, because we have natural disaster clauses, God forbid if we are hit tomorrow, we unlock 18% of GDP over the next 2 years, because what we do is effectively put a pause on all of our debt and put it at the end for 2 years and put it at the end, and we pay back that money at the end. But what we get is the flexibility in the first 2 years to address issues of damage and loss. And finally, we believe that the multilateral development banks have to reform. Yes, it is time for us to revisit Bretton Woods. Yes, it is time for us to remember that those countries who sit in this room today did not exist at the time that the Bretton Woods institutions were formed, for the most part. And therefore, we have not seen, we have not been heard sufficiently. And if we are therefore to rise to the occasion to play our part to stop the tragic loss of life that we have seen on these screens and the impact on livelihoods that we are feeling across our countries, then there needs to be a new deal with respect to the Bretton Woods institutions. And we need to ensure that they have a different view to their risk appetite, that we look at the SDRs, and that we look at other innovative ways to expand the lending that is available from billions to trillions. My friends, the time is running out on us. And yes, we have the power of choice. When asked what should he do when he became president of South Africa, should he pursue a path of vengeance or should he seek to build a state, Nelson Mandela chose to be able to build a state and to keep a country together. He chose blessings instead of curse because he believed that it would make a defining difference. When given the choice of how to treat to post-war Europe, President Truman settled the Marshall Plan that made the definable difference to the countries that were responsible, yes, for the destruction of so much and for the loss of life of so many. But in spite of that, they chose to rise above it. I ask us today, what will our choice be? We have the power to act or the power to remain passive and do nothing. I pray that we will leave Egypt with a clear understanding that the things that are facing us today are all interconnected. I thank President el-Sisi for his comments that there needs to be peace, because countries like ours continue to suffer as a result of a war that we have no part of, and a war that we want to see come to an end. Our people on this earth deserve better. And what is more, our leaders know better. Because while many of us may not have been alive during the great wars, the consequences of those wars still live with us, and we have the capacity to choose differently. I ask the people of the world, and not just the leaders, therefore, to hold us accountable and to ask us to act in your name to save this earth and to save the people of this earth. The choice is ours. What will you do? What will you choose to save? Thank you.
شكرا للسيدة ميا موتلي رئيسة وزراء دولة بربيدوس. هناك العديد من الطرق للتعبير عن هذه الظاهرة التي
There are several ways of describing this phenomenon which is harming our planet. Some think in terms of initiatives and others are thinking of implementation to bring about change, and there are of course others who are thinking and expressing themselves through art and inspiration.
she nourished them with her love. They were hungry for more.
مصر الكرام، شكرا للمشاركة في الدورة 27 من قمة المناخ.
Thank you for your participation in the opening ceremony of the 27th session of the Conference of Parties here in Sharm el-Sheikh, city of peace, city of the environment, city of hope. We are all convinced that we will be able to deliver the results expected of us. This collective action for implementation. Together for implementation. Thank you.